Good morning, everyone. I'm Alan Gingell from the Crawford School at the ANU and the HC Coombs Policy Forum. It's a great pleasure to welcome so many people here today. I want to begin by acknowledging that we're meeting on the traditional lands of the first Australians, custodians of humankind's oldest continuous civilization, and by paying our respects to the elders present and past of the Ngunnawal people. The HC Coombs Policy Forum, which has convened this conference, is part of an ongoing, indeed foundational, role of the ANU in informing and deepening the public policy debate in Australia. One of our jobs is that of a matchmaker, really, bringing together the best thinking going on in the research community with the needs of policymakers and business. And to do that, we have an absolutely stellar group of people here today, and I'm looking forward very much to all the sessions which lie ahead. My job at this stage is simply to introduce the Vice Chancellor of the ANU, Professor Ian Young, and invite him to get things going. Ian.
Thanks very much, Alan. Can I say on behalf of ANU, we're enormously proud to be convening this conference featuring such an incredible array of really influential scholars and practitioners in this field of public policy, and in particular, the gentleman on the stage here with me, Professor Cass Sunstein from Harvard University. We're delighted that he was able to be here with us for the meeting. ANU sees public policy as one of the real cornerstones of what we do as a university. Obviously, research and education are central to our mission, but we really believe that as the Commonwealth University, as a university located here in the national capital, public policy is something central to what we do, and our ability to be able to work with government and the public service to enhance public policy is something which is very important for many of the elements of the university. And the ANU Crawford School is central to that mission. It is the focal point for much of our public policy research, education, and indeed public debate. I'm delighted that not only the Crawford School, but the university continues to have very strong links with government at all levels. As Alan said, this conference, which is organised by the HC Coombs Public Policy Forum, explores emerging ideas and good practice in dealing with complex public policy issues. And I think it's not unreasonable to say that the public policy landscape and the environment we deal with today is possibly more complex and more uncertain than it's been for a very, very long period of time. And so this conference explores ways in which recent research on, in particular, behavioural insights can lead to more effective and innovative public policy making. So the real reason I'm here, however, today is that I'm delighted that Senator the Honourable Scott Ryan, the Assistant Cabinet Secretary in the Commonwealth Government, is able to address the conference today. The Senator was elected to the Senate in 2007 and then re-elected in 2013. And of course, in the Turnbull government, he was appointed in 2015 to the position of Assistant Cabinet Secretary. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the Senator to the lectern.
Well, thank you, Ian, for the kind introduction, and thank you for the welcome. Obviously, I bring the apologies of the Cabinet Secretary, my boss, Arthur Sinodinos, who's been called away on Cabinet business this morning, and I thank you for the kind and optimistic welcome, given that I know the agenda said you were here expecting to hear from Arthur. I've always thought that people who applaud before a speech are, by their nature, optimists, and it's important at the start of a conference. You have no idea how long I'm going to speak for, nor what I'm going to say, so I enjoy coming into such an optimistic crowd. To Alan, to Ian, thank you for the opportunity to speak. I had the opportunity to join the Crawford School's Leadership Forum conference last year, which was a fascinating way to get a group of politicians, but also decision makers. I imagine some people in this room, as well as media personalities and commentators there. It was a very, I think, important initiative to actually get a bit of cross-fertilisation. To oversee our overseas guests, and particularly Professor Sunstein, who I've just had the opportunity to meet, welcome as well. The theme for this conference, Designing Effective and Innovative Public Policy in a Complex Environment, summarises one of the key challenges governments face today. That these challenges are faced globally rather than simply here in Australia is demonstrated by the distinguished international speakers on the agenda for this conference. In public policy, as much as in the world of politics and business, there is great potential for collaborative innovation with our friends overseas. And on behalf of the government, I'd actually like to formally welcome all the international speakers here today. I note that at today's conference you will hear, and I'm sorry I can't be here to join you, from leading experts in behavioural insights, in particular from Professor Sunstein. The behavioural sciences are relative newcomers to public policy, but it's fair to say they have had a significant impact on public policy development in the last decade or so. Insights from the behavioural sciences have been successfully applied in public policy development internationally and here in Australia, and it is an area we are keen to further explore. For example, the Australian Taxation Office has been successful in using behavioural insights to improve taxpayers' experience and compliance. Tailored text messages sent to their phones have helped taxpayers avoid going into debt, and plain English debt letters using social norms have led to more people responding and paying on time. And the New South Wales government has successfully utilised behavioural insights to get injured workers back to work more quickly and safely. So I'm pleased to announce that the Commonwealth is going to establish a behavioural economics team of the Australian government, or BETA as it will become known. BETA will be established as a joint initiative of seven agencies to be housed within the Department of Prime Minister and Cabinet. And I'm delighted that Professor Michael Hiscox of Harvard has agreed to return home to Australia initially to head up the team. If I might add a personal insight, as I have found this area of research particularly fascinating, behavioural sciences, particularly as they are applied to economics, can provide fascinating insights into how current policy settings drive or deliver particular responses or results. However, while these tools help us understand the world as it is, they do not on their own automatically provide the political or public justification for using these tools to change policy or to seek to alter human behaviour. The challenge of generating public and stakeholder consent for policy change remains. It can never be assumed. Indeed, in some cases, generating this consent may even be more critical as proposals arise to use these tools to alter or drive very personal or individual lifestyle choices or preferences, for there is occasionally some resistance to state involvement in such choices. If I can now borrow for your conference theme, in a complex environment, the decision-making model of traditional cabinet government has proven itself over time to be an adaptable and reliable way of generating sound policy outcomes. The Prime Minister has made it clear that a traditional cabinet government will be the primary decision-making body of a government committed to delivering innovative policy to ensure Australia remains a high-wage, generous social safety net, first-world economy. Regardless of the problem you are seeking to solve, proper policy processes will nearly always deliver sound policy outcomes. And the key characteristics of proper processes are consultation, communication, and research, and then planning for effective implementation. If we look to international experience, for example, the Cameron government established the Major Projects Authority to make sure projects are delivered efficiently and effectively. Now, there's no single road to this destination, but translating good policy to a good experience on the ground, delivering a project or program on time and on budget, and actually achieving policy objectives rather than merely surrogate measures of success will remain a focus for the government and for the public service. Good governments have clear philosophies and objectives to which they must remain true, and all governments have some stakeholders more sympathetic than others. It is important that the Cabinet receive regular feedback from the backbench of the parliamentary party, those most committed to the philosophies and objectives of the government, to ensure that it is well informed on community expectations and issues. And major reforms require appropriate consultation with stakeholders, those sympathetic to the government's objectives and those not so sympathetic. The key being to consult widely rather than to elicit applause. The National Reform Summit of Business and Community Leaders was an example of minds meeting from across the spectrum of interests to consider and discuss the key reforms that will create jobs, drive innovation, and stimulate growth. These discussions occurred in depth and at length among the participants before the government's economic team, led by the Prime Minister, met with the members to discuss the reform agenda. It is an agenda that touches on many strands of business and community life, so it makes sense to review the issues with representatives from across the community and to try to find common ground. Of course, good advice supported by research is essential to successful reform, and the government has a tremendous resource in the Australian Public Service. In the modern world, all advice is contestable, and public servants are a bit like the ringmaster in the chaos of it all. There have been a few people of late harking back to an imagined golden age of the APS, stating by implication or sometimes directly that the contemporary public service is not fit to advise on or deliver reform. My own view, and I know this is the view of Senator Sinodinos, is that today's APS is indeed fit for purpose for a government bent on reform. And beyond the anecdotal, the evidence for that lies in the big reforms it has and is delivering. Examples include the design, development, conceptualisation of the NDIS, a world-class initiative of consumer-centred care for people with disability. And on the delivery side, in relation to the government's Indigenous procurement policy, there has been a 600% increase in Commonwealth procurement from Indigenous firms in the first 4 months of this financial year compared to the previous year. The APS is the primary source of nuanced policy advice, and its expertise, augmented by good corporate memory, is essential to good public policy making. Of course, the most perfectly formed policy in the world, if poorly implemented, will fail to meet its objectives. More than that, poorly implemented policy can levy considerable costs on the community, even causing death, as we saw in the case of the home insulation program. Planning for effective implementation, listening to stakeholders and the community, and adapting to what you hear limits the risk that policy will go off the rails. In the course of shaping and delivering public policy, agencies naturally generate a huge amount of data, not all of which they or we use effectively or comprehensively. We see it as an untapped resource, and the government is committed to maximising the use and reuse of public sector data across the whole economy. And I know this conference is devoting considerable time to the question of developing innovative public policy and data use. Innovation extends beyond new policy ideas. It also extends to devising innovative ways to deliver existing policy and to improving administration. It is part of the promise of the digital era, and the government has established an executive agency called the Digital Transformation Office to ensure Australians reap that promise by improving the quality of their engagement with government. When people can find the information and services they need online, they have a better experience. Conversely, when they can't find the information online easy, they waste time and become frustrated. Getting information out of your government and easily is a basic service in a democracy, but it is also an economic issue. Of the estimated 811 million transactions with government agencies every year, around 40% are still completed using non-digital channels. According to a report from Deloitte Access Economics, if over the next 10 years this was reduced to 20%, the change would deliver around $17.9 billion in savings to government and a further $8.7 billion in savings for Australians through time, convenience and out-of-pocket savings. Regulatory reforms, as one of the themes of this conference, is also one of the government's priorities. Too often, governments resort to regulation as our first response. We're changing that thinking so that regulation is not seen as a costless way to address policy issues. But even where we have good regulation, the way as it is administered and applied by regulators can have a major effect on productivity. That is why we've also set out clear expectations for the performance of Commonwealth regulators. They need to minimise their impact on those they regulate while still delivering the vital roles for which they have been created. And they will report publicly on their performance every year. But our goal is not only to reduce the cost of complying with regulation. We have strengthened our regulatory reform agenda to make sure that when regulation is necessary, it is designed to support flexibility in our economy and encourage innovation to the greatest extent possible. Our government will be targeting productivity-enhancing regulatory reform priorities. At the same time, we will continue to reduce red tape. This helps to keep reducing costs for businesses, community organisations and individuals. This is essential reform if the government is to achieve both the productivity growth, which is necessary to support rising living standards. The Prime Minister likes to say there has never been a better time to be an Australian. I agree, as with most of my colleagues, and add that there has never been a better time to be engaged in public policy in Australia. The government has an ambitious policy agenda, including the tax white paper, the Federation reform process, the upcoming innovation statement, and the government response to the Harper Competition Review. We face significant challenges, but we have a vast potential in this country that is more than equal to meeting these challenges. Many of the policy settings we have are right, but government must be as nimble and responsive to change as the rest of society and the economy. This government is absolutely committed to orderly and effective processes, to reaching within government to get the best advice from the public service, and reaching beyond in consulting with the community. That includes the academic community. And while I can't stay, somewhat disappointingly, to hear some of the presentations later today, I'll be most interested in hearing the insights developed during this conference. I wish you all robust and fruitful discussions, and I'm pleased to formally declare the conference open.
Well, thank you very much. I'll now invite the head of the Crawford School, my boss, Bob Brunig, to introduce Cass Sunstein.
Thanks, Alan. Good morning, everyone. Welcome. Thanks, Alan. As Alan said, I'm the director of the Crawford School of Public Policy. As the Vice Chancellor said, policy and public policy is a key focus for every part of the Australian National University. It's something we take a lot of pride in. Within the Crawford School, we take a particular pride in our public policy outreach. We're working with pretty much every government agency that's represented here in the room. I have colleagues working with the AFP. I have colleagues working with Productivity Commission, with innovation, with industry, with immigration. So as you're thinking about the development of public policy, the implementation of it, the evaluation of it, by all means, use your contacts in the ANU to help you think about that. If you don't know where to start, give us a call at the Crawford School and we'll try to help you out. I can put you in the right direction. So we're really honored to have Cass Sunstein here, who's the author of Nudge. As I read Cass's biography, which I won't go through in great detail, you can Google that sort of stuff for yourself, but he is the Robert Walmsley professor at Harvard, and he's in charge of the Behavioral Economics and Public Policy Group at the Harvard Law School. He also spent 4 years in the Obama administration. And I just had two quick reflections when I read your bio. One is that, although one of my reflections has sort of been dampened by the announcement that was just made by the senator, one of my reflections was going to be how frequent it is in the US that academics are brought into government and asked to help out in the development of policy. And that doesn't seem to happen much in Australia. And I'd be interested to hear from people during tea breaks and stuff why you think that is, and whether you think it would be a good thing if we could change that. So I welcome the announcement about the beta team and the use of an academic in making government policy. I think it's a great thing. And Australia, it's not that we don't have the expertise, right? We've got four or five universities ranked in the top 100 in the world. We've got people in competencies across all the range of things the government does. So I would definitely encourage you to make use of academia. And then my second reflection was just that I'm really happy about the rise of behavioral economics, because it gives me a lot of faith in economics as a science. What science does is it looks at empirics and it makes theory. And then real science takes that theory and confronts the world. And when it finds out that there's a mismatch between theory and evidence, it doesn't close itself behind doors and say, well, we're just going to ignore that. It says, well, let's think about making new theory and better theory that actually matches with the evidence. And I think that's what behavioral economics is all about. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Cass Sunstein, who we're very fortunate to have visiting. Yeah, so we'll go about 45 minutes and then have questions for 25, 30 minutes afterwards. Is that a good format?
That's great.
Great, thanks.
Okay, it's an honor and a thrill to be here. I'm amazed by what you're all doing here on innovation and on behavioral science. I've learned from my short time here that Australia is really one of the world's leaders in innovating here. In some ways, you've gone well beyond where other countries have, so hats off to you. In terms of academics and government, I was privileged to work for President Obama, and I'll just make one little notation. I learned early on, maybe in the first week, that the characteristic academic skills are not a positive in government. And in some ways, they're a negative. So it occurred to me, I had, you know, in public policy, part of my background is in behavioral science and in nudge-related work. And before I even used the word nudge in government, it occurred to me, if I said, you know, this is a good time to nudge, the best response might have been, it's a good time for you to go back to Cambridge. And that's related to what I'm going to be talking about today. So there's obviously a concern on the part of some that self-government and uses of behavioral science are potentially on a collision course. And there is sensitivity on the part of citizens of a democratic nation about uses of psychology and behavioral science to make policies more effective. And that concern is something we should celebrate. It's part of what a free society brings up. So one thing I've been involved in the last few months is trying to figure out what people actually think. The answers matter in a democratic society. If you get a green light from the public, that's an important fact. If you get something like a red light, that's not only an important fact, it might have some value in trying to figure out when you've gone wrong and maybe crossed an ethical line. I'm going to give you some US data. There's a lot more from other countries, and I'll give you a hint of that. So here are some popular nudges in the United States. Calorie labels. Overwhelming support for calorie labels. Graphic warnings for cigarettes of the sort that you have here, many nations have, very strong support, 3/4. Automatic enrollment and savings plans, supplemental to mandatory savings. There is strong support for government encouraging, and there's strong support for government requiring a default rule to this effect. So a nudge that takes a form of above the mandatory, a default, very strong support. Traffic lights for food, that's more aggressive than calorie labeling. Red for unhealthy, green for very healthy. Americans like that, very strong majority support. To my great surprise, there is strong support for automatic enrollment in green energy. In fact, over 2/3 of Americans favor a mandate that companies automatically enroll people in green energy, subject to easy opt-out if it's more expensive. Americans are nervous about a mandate, they're supportive of a nudge. A campaign to combat obesity, you get overwhelming support for that, and so too a campaign to combat distracted driving. To my immense surprise, the approval in the cases I've given is bipartisan. We do not observe differences across party lines. Whether people are liberals or conservatives, they're supportive of the things I've just described. People don't like subliminal advertising to encourage healthy eating. Are you amazed at that? Americans don't like the idea that the government would mandate subliminal advertising in movie theaters. In fact, I use that as a kind of reality check for my own survey. If people like that, I get worried about my survey. Fortunately, people don't like that. People also don't like automatic charitable deductions. They strongly oppose the idea that an employer, private or public, would say, you are presumed to give a small portion of your money to charity. People are against that. I think the underlying principle is that people get to decide actively and not by default where their money's going. People don't like an educational campaign to get mothers to stay at home to take care of their kids. I think they think that reflects illicit values. Insofar as the government is not operating pursuant to legitimate goals, and insofar as the government is acting inconsistently with the values and interests of choosers, there is going to be nervousness about behaviorally informed approaches. But so long as those principles are complied with, people are enthusiastic about choice-preserving interventions. To my near astonishment, the results in the United States are replicated essentially identically in France, Germany, Denmark, Italy, Hungary, and the United Kingdom. You're the first people who are hearing this data. It hasn't been published yet. It's just been collected. But as a first approximation with some variations that aren't that relevant for now, there seems to be a consensus across democratic nations in the organizing principles I've just described. Okay, in the United States, there is a centralized entity called the Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs. It has the unpronounceable acronym OIRA. That's pre-behavioral science, that acronym. I was privileged to oversee that office in the first term of the Obama administration. There are two basic ideas. Regulations have to be justified and subject to cost-benefit analysis, and there will be managerial control and interagency coordination. Those are the dominant ideas. And notice, if you would, that the office has veto authority, which is to say that regulations that are submitted to it are not going to be issued unless it approves of them with effective appeal to the president. So the organization, a little different from what I'm learning about Australia, is that there's a no opportunity for a minister or a cabinet department to issue a regulation without that office's approval, except that if the office is acting in an idiosyncratic or eccentric way, it will retreat, and accept that the President of the United States has ultimate say. The benefits have to justify the cost. Less restrictive and burdensome approaches must be considered, and that is an invitation to choice-preserving, behaviorally informed interventions, and distributional considerations, equity, and fairness can count. In fact, President Obama made one kind of historic change in the catalog of non-quantitative values that play a role in regulatory decision making. It has implications for behavioral science as well as more generally. And that is, he uses the term human dignity as a foundation of his principles for regulatory judgment. Okay, here's a little tale. That picture is actually a candid, it wasn't posed, and it's relevant to here. During one of our not very exciting government shutdowns, when Congress and the president were at loggerheads and the government actually shut down, do you remember that? We're not proud of that. We don't think that's an excellent moment for our country. But some of us got to go in, and it's, you know, enough of a privilege that that's the right phrase. We got to go in, even in the midst of the government shutdown. And I was walking across to the White House, and I heard someone call my name, and it was the president. And while I worked with him at the University of Chicago, so it's not that odd, he's president now, and to hear him call one's name while you're walking, that's not usual. And that conversation was one in which he was facing a very difficult domestic situation, but he really wanted to talk about regulatory policy. And to my amazement, during the midst of not quite a crisis, but a very difficult situation, he said, we have to focus very much on simplifying our regulatory structure, eliminating things that are too burdensome for people, finding ways to increase simplicity, and using, if we can, behaviorally informed approaches to help serve the American people better. Okay, that's related to what happened in 2012, which is something like a constitution for our regulatory state. It has a not very exciting name, Executive Order 13563. Can you remember that? 13 is kind of an unlucky number. Does 563 have any athletic resonance? I saw some sport on TV last night that was very hard to understand. They were falling down a lot. Is 563 relevant to that sport? Okay, well, we don't have a mnemonic. Maybe you can think of one. Okay, this executive order from 2012 has a provision, it's short. Its provision says each agency shall identify and consider approaches that reduce burdens and maintain flexibility and freedom of choice for the public. And the bold letter is can be understood as a reference to behaviorally informed approaches. Warnings, default rules, and disclosure requirements as well as provision of information to the public in a form that is clear and intelligible. Okay, September 2015, very recently, the president issued a new executive order, which is basically the behavioral science executive order. And in terms of our operations in our government, what happened just a couple of months ago, it's a genuinely historic event. To understand its magnitude, note, if you would, that an executive order from the president has the force of law. It is binding on the rest of the federal government. The president has directive authority over those who work for him, and this is like law. And you're just seeing quotations from the executive order, which tells the government to design its policies in a way that reflects the understandings that behavioral science has called up. It requires agencies to identify chances to help qualifying people who may not be able to benefit from programs by removing burdens, shortening wait times, and simplifying forms, using the content format, timing, and median to facilitate comprehension. Consider how presentation and structure of choices can effectively promote public welfare, including use of default settings. And here's potentially the biggest one. Review elements of policies and programs that are designed to encourage and make it easier for people to take specific actions by considering timing and opportunities of use for use of non-financial incentives. Okay, here are some practical challenges that I think all governments face. I thought of this, what I'm about to tell you, many times when I was in the government, and I've thought of it frequently since. At the University of Chicago, where I taught for over 20 years, there was a very distinguished older professor who, in response to any new idea, would say either, "We did that," or, "We never did that." And those two answers exhausted the possibilities. There was nothing that they either did or didn't do. That's 100%, which meant any new idea would be bad. It was already done, or of course, it wasn't done. The best, I think, way to face down this kind of devastating "we did, we never did" is to notice that government is usually problem-driven, not theory-driven. Those of you who work for the government are completely aware of this. To bring abstractions down to policymakers or bureaucrats is not an excellent idea. To use either persuasion by emphasizing the potential benefits of one or another approach, as has been done by David Cameron's group in the United Kingdom, and frequently by the US analog, or to use authority by saying this is actually what has to happen, either of those are good. If you have authority, use it. That's quicker. But otherwise, persuasion. My most surprising moment in the US government, actually, there was one that was the most stunning. It's our president issued an open government memorandum, which was followed by a directive from the Office of Management and Budget, where I had part of the lead, and we required the rest of our government to do lots of things to open government up to the American people, including having a website called data.gov that now exists, which has a ton of information available to the world. We had an initial meeting with the rest of our government, many of them civil servants, to talk about implementation of the directive. And my feeling in the pit of the stomach when we had the meeting, which I was running, was a little like the feeling of the pit of the stomach when you're taking a test, you know you're going to fail, or encountering a group of people who you know don't like you. This was going to be a difficult meeting. To my stunned surprise, the meeting was electric with excitement that the people in the government were thrilled at the idea that the particular problems they wanted to solve, they now had a kind of license from the policymakers to go forward and use their own creativity. So there was a kind of unleashing of innovative capacity on government's part, And the hope is that, that's what we can observe in the behavioral domain. Okay, there's a nudge. Big elephant is nudging a little elephant. That's a scandalous nudge. That's, the men know, that's a urinal. Women, if you haven't seen one before, that's exactly what they look like. But this isn't just any urinal. This is a urinal from the Netherlands airport. The fly you see on the in the urinal, that's not a real fly. That's a painted fly. And the reason for the painted fly is that there's a bad problem of spillage in the airport. And the thought was that men could be nudged to aim better. And the consequence of the painted fly was to reduce spillage by 44%. I don't know exactly how they measured that, and I don't think I want to know. But apparently men, once they see the fly, can't help but aim at it. Now, what's revealing about this example is not only that it helped reduce a not completely trivial problem, but that it shows the great relevance of attention in human decision making. Reminders, I think, are the sleeper nudge, as through text messages, and reminders are the equivalent of a painted fly. They bring something to people's attention. This is an actual postcard someone recently sent me from Germany. I don't speak German. It's a real postcard. Now, I don't speak German, but I think I understand that postcard. Okay, here are some uses of behavioral science. Default rules, disclosure, warnings, reminders. Okay. I'm just trying to make sure you're paying attention. That's like a fly. Okay, there we go. Choice architecture is, of course, a way of dealing with one or another problem. And choice architecture should be designed for choice architects. As through a requirement of cost-benefit analysis, that is choice architecture for choice architects. I have a number for you, which is $150 billion. And that number is the net benefits of federal regulations in the first term of the Obama administration, which is a reflection of the president's concern in an economically challenging time to be extremely disciplined about regulatory output and to ensure that the regulations that are issued either have the principal consequence of just eliminating costs, and some of those billion dollars are from cost elimination, or of having benefits that dwarf costs. The president recently said, just a few weeks ago, he said publicly, we don't issue a regulation if the benefits don't exceed the costs. And that reflects actual practice. That was his direction to me, and that's the data. Okay, what I'm going to do now is just give you a list of behaviorally informed initiatives from the US government, hoping that each of them will be of some interest in its own right, and also possibly suggestive of other things that might be useful here. So that's the basic goal. If there's a problem we have in the United States that there are children who are eligible for nutritious school meals. They're poor. They're entitled to the food. But the parents don't sign them up. Why don't the parents sign them up? We don't know for sure, but they might be busy, frightened, suspicious, or confused. There are various ways that those problems could be addressed through a simplified, less threatening, or completely, clearly unthreatening communication from the federal government, but those are labor intensive and it's not clear that they'd work. So the initiative instead is called direct certification. It says that if you, local government or school, know these children are eligible, given what you know about their economic situation, then they're in automatically. And the result of the program, as of last accounting, was to certify 12 million children for meals to which they're legally entitled. It was just a nudge, just switch the default rule. Federal Reserve Board in 2010 was concerned very much about the problem of people automatically enrolled by their banks in so-called overdraft protection programs. It's a nice term, isn't it? Overdraft protection programs. One wants to be in one of those. The problem is, if you're in an overdraft protection program and you go over your checking account, you will be taking out the equivalent of a very high interest loan, possibly as high as 7,000%. And people haven't signed up for those loans. The Federal Reserve said, banks, you cannot do that. And it emphasized both the importance of the default rule and the risk of unrealistic optimism. Significant results have been observed from the switching of the default rule, where a lot of people aren't paying those high interest loans because they're not in those programs. I know the savings issue has particular resonance and wrinkles here. Our president has tried to supplement our Social Security program, not through additional mandates, but through automatic enrollment. That has been a transformative set of initiatives from the private and public sector. Here you can see the magnitude of the transformation. And if the savings issue particularly seems, you know, for other countries, think of this as a tribute to the power of automaticity. At every level of the income distribution, we're seeing very significant increases in participation rates by virtue of automatic enrollment. The stunning number, I think, is the one that involves people at the lower end, where they're more than doubling their participation rates by view of automatic enrollment. And that is likely to have very significant distributional impact in the long term, where people who are likely to struggle, particularly in older age, are going to have a pot of money from which they can benefit. In Germany, there was recently a randomized controlled trial involving about 40,000 households, in which 20,000 were asked if they want to opt in to cleaner energy. The result was relatively low, and the best predictor of whether people were going to get in was whether they were in the Green Party. The other 20,000 were automatically enrolled in green energy and were told, if you want to opt out, go for it, it's easy. That increased participation rates by tenfold, and after the automatic enrollment program was in, for people who were in that condition, whether you were in the Green Party had no relationship to whether you ended up green. That's kind of the German version, I think, of what you're now witnessing on the slide for the public policy problem which Germany is keenly concerned to address, which is the clean energy problem. Notice that this is an essentially costless intervention. Notice also that the participation rates increased for people who actually had to pay a little more for green energy. Notice as well that a follow-up suggested people completely knew what they were doing. They weren't tricked or trapped. They thought instead, I'm in green energy. Okay, that's fine. The people who stayed in. Okay, that's the study. A little tiny footnote to the study is that if you have a default rule in favor of double-sided printing, you can save a lot of money easily. Much more than through education about paper use, which saves approximately zero money, and much more than taxing paper use, which has a smaller impact. Okay, there's the old United States Department of Agriculture food pyramid. And what I found in our government was that many of our interactions with the American people were basically like this. Now, let me explain what this is. This is something designed by experts who worked really hard on it. So this is not designed by people who were cruel or mischievous. They're good people, and they know what they're doing. And what they thought was, if we take a person, gender unclear, that's good. This is not a guy or a woman. It's just a person walking to the top of a pyramid, we will provide some clarity to people about what they should be eating. Now ask yourself, have they succeeded in that task? There are stripes of various colors, aren't there, in the pyramid. Do you understand what those stripes refer to? I work on this stuff and I actually have no idea. I think at one point I probably knew, I have no idea. Is red mapping onto some kind of food group? Maybe. Can you recognize the foods in the slide? Is any of them recognizable? I recognize only one food in the slide. It's on the bottom right, and that's very clearly a shoe. Is the government suggesting you should eat a shoe? Okay, we eliminated that and did this instead. This is the food plate, which says essentially make half your plate fruits and vegetables, and if you do that, you're on the way towards a healthy diet. Our food plate has gone viral in the United States. It's in Spanish, it's being used all over the place, and it gives clarity. Now, in government, I think the following idea is a good organizing theme. Plate, not pyramid. It's good if you're a parent also. Plate, not pyramid. And I'll give a little explanation of why that is, seems to me a useful organizing term. I had a friend who was involved a couple of years ago in a very high-level negotiation with another country from the United States. The negotiation was not with Australia, it was not with Russia, it was not with Israel. It didn't have that level of tension in it, but it had a potential tension, I should say, but it had was important, and nothing had developed at the time. President was going in a couple of days, and we had no agreement with the country. That's not good. If the president is going to another nation, there should be something that's a product of the visit. My friend was there to try to rescue the situation, and it looked doomed. And I talked to my friend the night after the negotiation took place, expecting failure. And I asked, how did it go? And the answer exploded in my cell phone, great. And I said, how come? How did that happen? And the answer was, plate, not pyramid. And that's my phrase. I had no idea what it meant in that context. And I asked, what do you mean? And the answer was that the negotiation was going badly because we had presented something like this. And the other country said, no. Once we presented something like this with eight things, each of which was crystal clear, the other country said, well, six of those look good. Let's talk about the other two. Which is a suggestion that when there is non-compliance or a failure to benefit from a government program, a failure of usage, it's often not because of resistance, it's because of confusion. And that if one can make clarity, then things that otherwise fail can kind of snap into line. Okay, here's the old fuel economy label in the United States. This has our measure miles per gallon, and I'm thinking that every country has its equivalent of miles per gallon, meaning not some other number that is identical in meaning, but some other unhelpful term that only specialists understand. Miles per gallon, what that maps onto that matters is extremely unclear in terms of environmental effects or economic effects. If you know what the miles per gallons are, you don't know much. You have to do a translation exercise. We abandoned the old fuel economy label in favor of this, and this may be a bit too cluttered. We did some data to suggest whether that this would be pretty good, but to iterate it is a very good idea. Here are two things to notice about the new one. It tells you your annual fuel cost in big letters, and it tells you how much you are going to spend or save basically over the life of the vehicle. So it gives you something you care about. It gives you a measure that is like a plate. Okay, our Consumer Financial Protection Bureau has a mantra, know before you owe. I think it's a good mantra. It is saying not that we're going to have aggressive regulation of the financial sector in order to produce the form of interaction that we, the government, think best between consumers and banks. Saying we're going to work very hard to make sure that people actually understand what they're getting into. The subprime crisis was in large part a failure of understanding, and there are things to do to make Know Before You Owe a reality. This is 2014, our Food and Drug Administration, which is altering its nutrition facts panel to try to increase clarity about relevant features of potato chips, ice cream, et cetera. And it emphasizes the behavioral economics findings, especially about present bias and salience, which are suggestive of how to make one of those better. I believe Australia just joined the Open Government Partnership. Does one of you know this is true? Some of you are nodding. Very recently, the Open Government Partnership was created a few years ago. It's worldwide. It's not a, you know, narrowly, let's say, Western nations effort to promote Western understandings of how government should work. It's using what are seen as more universal values of openness to promote a multitude of goals. My plea is that Australia might, as other countries have found possible, exploit participation in the Open Government Partnership as a way of developing national action plans to make their own governments work better. My experience in the US government when we joined the Open Government Partnership was, this is great for the world, but it's a bit challenging. We, the United States, have to generate a national action plan. In view of the limitations of time, an additional task is not always welcome, but it turned out that our own national action plan actually helped us to serve the American people much better, and as the program works, it's done a little bit. New plans basically every year or so. Okay, there it is, blue. Attractive, yes? Okay, you already saw this. This is making sure you're paying. This is a reminder. Okay, fuel economy rules. Here we're speaking not of nudges or choice-preserving approaches quite, but of more aggressive regulations that have a behavioral foundation. So just notice here that in the United States, fuel economy rules are getting much more aggressive in a relatively short time. And I'm going to say something in a moment about the behavioral foundations of that initiative. Okay. At the same time that the president issued his executive order on behavioral science, the White House Social and Behavioral Sciences team issued its annual report. And it's a long report. I'm just going to give you a flavor. An email campaign to increase savings by service members nearly doubled enrollment in federal savings plans. It's a significant boost. Simple text messages to lower income students reminding them to complete forms. This is a lot like the fly on the urinal. Increased college enrollment by 5.7%. Farmers are allowed to get some loans from the federal government on favorable terms, but they seem like background noise, often the communications. A new outreach letter significantly increased the percentage of people who obtained loans. Adding a new signature box on an online form requiring self-certification of self-reported sales produced an additional $1.59 million in fees in just one quarter. Now, in the scheme of things, $1.59 million isn't huge, but it's suggestive of opportunities to have choice architecture interventions that increase honesty. Okay, I promised to tell you something about energy efficiency and behavior. Here's a quotation from the US government that bears on fuel economy and energy efficiency in general. Suggestion is that consumers might be myopic and undervalue the long term. They might lack full appreciation of information even when it's presented. They might be averse to short-term losses, and they might not have sufficient salience with respect to information. Now, there are a lot of mites here, which is honest. We need to have more empirical work on energy efficiency and human behavior. But the mites are based on empirical research existing, which suggests that energy efficiency interventions can often not just reduce externalities, environmental and other harms, but also have major effects in protecting consumers against economic losses. Okay, our Department of Agriculture has gone big on behavioral economics using a wide range of behavioral findings to try to encourage healthier choices. And there's a great deal of work on the problem of obesity and its aggravation by, let's say, bad choice architecture. I know Australia, like many nations, though this is a very thin audience, I know Australia, like many nations, is seeing a hike in obesity rates, and there's lots of things that can be done that preserve choice that that attack the problem. Okay, if I had one wish for my government in the next 6 months, I think this would be it in terms of uses of behavioral science. That is, not because it's necessarily the largest impact approach, but because it's the one that can deliver the most short-term wins. The idea here is that there are paperwork and reporting requirements all throughout the government which impose significant hurdles to participation in programs that involve small businesses, poverty reduction, help for people who suffer from mental illness or chronic pain, which are the two problems that behavioral science has shown it's hardest for people to adapt to, mental illness and chronic pain. There are programs designed to help, but sometimes participation in those programs is like navigating the food pyramid. If we can free people up not to spend their precious time on paperwork and prevent programs from being undermined or defeated by complexity, then whatever your policy goal, it's likely to be achieved on the cheap through an intervention. Simplification of our financial aid form has been found to have the same impact on college attendance as a several thousand dollar increase in the per person subsidy. If you have two choices for increasing college attendance, give people a lot more money or simplify the form, you probably should choose the latter. A terrific program, I'm sure you have your analogies here in the United States, in some ways our best poverty reduction program, is the Earned Income Tax Credit. With respect to economics, health, children's well-being, everything you care about under the sun, it's a big winner. But we don't have 100% participation rates. Take-up is too low. What can be done to make take-up of programs increased, often through simplification and default rules? Okay, so there's a person in the US government, someone who I think is one of our best public servants, a good friend of the president. I won't mention him, but he has a great term, which is, in a meeting, as ideas are discussed and arguments and counterarguments are raised, he will say at a certain point, okay, we've admired the problem, now what are we gonna do about it? The idea, which a good cautionary note for academics or people with academic inclinations, is that admiring the problem is often greatly overrated. Here is, after 3 years, the net benefits of federal regulations across the three past administrations. Now, the Bush ones are over $3 billion, and while it's the smallest, that is not something to sneeze at. That's $3 billion in net benefits. That's pretty big. But the Obama administration's, it's now well over $150 billion through the 5 years, through $450. This comparison sheet shows you the potential benefits of kind of consistent focus on evidence and numbers. Okay, directions and new dilemmas. I'm just going to tell you two sets of things about what seem to me on the horizon. Often a good way to nudge people is just to ask them to make a choice. We had a discussion last night of organ donation where it would be possible to have presumed consent, so people just assume to be organ donors. Not clear that's a good idea. It may seem disrespectful to people. But if you just ask people when they get their driver's license or whatever, do you want to be an organ donor? That can have a very significant effect on participation rates. I understand from part of Australia, the rates have been dramatically increased just by asking people what they want. If I ask you what I'm about to ask you, and it's a pretty big group, are you going to get a car in the next year? I think I've just increased the purchases of cars from this group in the next year. Just asking people a question typically increases the likelihood of the relevant behavior, even if they're not forced to make a choice, because it brings it to mind. Active choosing is itself a form of libertarian paternalism. It's steering people in a way that preserves freedom of choice. And it's a good question, what are the potential uses and limits of that as the simplest nudge of all? An alternative is to use personalized default rules. Now, often default rules are general. They apply to the mass of people. But as government, as the senator was suggesting, has detailed information about people, you can devise a communication or a default rule that is particularly suited to that person's situation. That seems to me a wave of the future. And while it's potentially threatening to privacy, it also is potentially far more effective than anything else we could do. Okay, there's a great basketball coach in the United States who says, it's not what you say, it's what they hear. I had that phrase rippling through my mind in government because often our communications would result in hearing something that we hadn't said. A single communication, whether it involves taxes or consumer protection or poverty relief, will often have very different meanings to different groups, and the beauty of it is on the basis of evidence we can find out. A savings default, an environmental default, may be poorly suited for some people and well suited for others. That also suggests potential much more differentiation than governments have had in the past. Okay, what we're learning with respect to poverty is that it's a little like loneliness and hunger and busyness. If people have no friends, they often have a hard time making friends because they're focused on their friendlessness, which isn't very likable. If someone is hungry, then when they see a movie that, let's say, is about cricket, but there's an apple on the screen, they might think this is a movie about apples. That's where their mind goes. The problem with poverty is in part, a problem of limited kind of processing capacity, which is overwhelmed by the fact that people have to focus on their financial situations. If you ask people who are poor to take an intelligence test, typically, they're going to do about as well as people who are not poor. If you ask people who are poor to solve a math problem and then take an intelligence test, and you ask non-poor people to solve the same math problem and take an intelligence test, they'll do the same. They're about the same. But if you ask poor people to solve a difficult financial challenge, say their car is broken down and they have to come up with a significant sum of money, how are they going to handle that? And then ask them to take an IQ test, an intelligence test, their intelligence plummets. If you ask people who aren't poor, how are they going to come up with enough money to fix their car, and then take an IQ test, it has no effect on their IQ intelligence. Poor people's intelligence falls after the solve a financial problem inquiry by the same amount, roughly, as your IQ intelligence falls if you've had no sleep the night before. Which is to suggest the problem of poverty is often a problem of cognitive scarcity. Governments, I think, have not taken that problem sufficiently on board. It's a behavioral problem. MIT economist Esther DeFlo has a passage discussing poverty, saying that we often think that the problem poor people face is they don't take enough responsibility for their own lives. But she says we should stop berating poor people for not taking responsibility and think instead of the ways in which people who aren't poor don't have to take responsibility because so many things are taken care of for them. if we, who are not poor, do nothing, we are on the right track. If they, who are under conditions of severe deprivation, do nothing, they are on the wrong track. That's a suggestion that there are pleasing and comfortable default rules with respect to air quality, water quality, medical care, education, almost everything under the sun that people who are not poor benefit from. That has policy implications, I think, for multiple interactions between government and citizens. Okay, agenda. Focus on high costs and low benefits. What are the best candidates for looking back at existing policies? We need to know more about public approval and disapproval. Over the last decades, there's been a lot of focus on performance standards being better than design standards. Don't tell people how to do things, tell them what you want them to do. Also on incentives versus commands, give people incentives, not commands. Choice architecture, I think, has the same relationship to performance standards as those standards have to the design standards, and the same relationship to incentives as incentives do to commands. If you're with me, they're softer and more freedom promoting. Okay, here's a final word from the greatest of the many great Irish poets, Yeats, of course. Don't wait to strike till the iron is hot. Make it hot by striking. That's a nudge. Thanks.
Extraordinarily disciplined and right on time. Very good. So I think we have microphones available so that people can ask questions. I have about a half a dozen questions, but I won't abuse my privilege of being the chair. So who'd like to ask a question? How about here in the front?
Good. You pointed to the extraordinary results of auto-enrolment for low people in low-income people in savings programs. In Australia, which presumably has an opt-out, right, attached to it. In Australia, we never went down that route. We have compulsory superannuation, 9.5%. Doesn't matter how dire your circumstances, you've got to put 9.5%. You can't opt out. If we had tried that, or if we tried it now, do you think we'd still achieve fairly high and appropriately high savings rates?
Probably. So empirical question, so be reckless of me to say anything more firm than probably, but probably. So I guess the policy design question would be, is that 9.5% evidence-based in the sense that it's an optimal population-wide average without adverse effects on people at one or another end of the income distribution? By international standards, I guess it's high. Maybe it's working. If there were something like, let's say, a 5% mandatory minimum and automatic enrollment for the rest, it's an empirical question, what would happen? You get a significant number of opt-outs, undoubtedly. The question is where significant is intentionally ambiguous. Right? I don't mean to say a percentage, but more than de minimis. And then the question would be, would those significant numbers of opt-outs be disturbing because they're a reflection of present bias, where people are just, you know, focusing on their current self and not caring about their future self? Or is it rational enough in the sense that people are thinking of income over the course of a lifespan, and they're thinking, you know, I need to pay off a loan now, or I'm buying a house now, and I'm going to be fine. So that's how maybe one would think of it. One thing that's, I think, interesting is the idea of 9.5% period, or 9.5% exclamation point, versus something that would have, you know, maybe 7% and an automatic enrollment supplement, or 8% and an automatic enrollment supplement, or you could imagine multiple designs. And it's not clear, it's certainly not clear that 9% exclamation point is better than 8.5% with automatic enrollment.
There was a question here in the front row. Thanks.
By the way, this half of the room, if you don't ask a question, you have to pay $4. This half of the room, if you do ask a question, you will get $4. So we're doing a little experiment here.
Who's paying the $4? Go ahead.
Just on the question of the public attitudes towards nudges, you used the example early about people don't like campaigns to encourage women to stay at home. Is the flip side that they're actually comfortable with campaigns to encourage women back into work? And is that, or is it a sphere where people think government shouldn't be going?
People are very enthusiastic about education campaigns across partisan lines in all of the countries I described. I'll give you one little qualification that I don't understand quite yet, but in a moment. But basically, public education campaigns that involve what people perceive as a genuine social problem, people want that. If they think that the public education campaign is designed to it would transgress social norms as they are rightly understood, people don't want that. So they don't want women to be encouraged to be in the home. I think they think that's retrograde. I tried one basically as a, in a way, very extreme, which was a public education campaign to make it clear to people that they can change their gender. I thought that was going to, everyone basically, except for a very small percentage of people, maybe 5% would be against that. Not because it's a public education campaign, but because most Americans, 2015, that's not the public education one would expect they want. And people don't want that. But some pretty high percent did. Something like 30% thought, okay, go for it. Let people know that. The little qualification I've got is in Hungary, all of the positive numbers basically are lower than in the other countries. I think I understand that there's a high level of distrust of government in Hungary right now. And so anything like this is going to be depressed a bit. Significant lower numbers, not massively lower, but significant lower. I think I understand that. There's one that is more mysterious, which Denmark looks like Hungary. Denmark, they're basically for education campaigns, but less so than in the other countries. And in some cases, you'll have a 65% majority in most countries, and in Denmark, it'll be 48%. Unclear why.
Just had a question about, I think you mentioned that new regulations, I presume it is, have to pass a cost-benefit test. A recent report from the General Accountability Office in the US said that the federal government doesn't have a comprehensive list of federal programs, and of course there's a large number of programs that don't have a good evidence base. So it seems like there's a long way gone on regulation, but not so far with programs. My question was, is there a move in the US to get better evidence base of the effectiveness of programs so that perhaps monies can be moved towards more effective rather than less effective programs?
Okay, great. So let's start with regulations. Every new regulation that has a degree of significance has to go through the process I described. But there's a stock of regulations on the books, and there's a way of knowing how many that haven't been subject to empirical reassessment. That is a very serious problem. And as part of the executive order, whose name you remember? 563. There's a regulatory look back requirement agencies are under every 6 months. The initial returns from the empirical reassessment were very high. Subsequently, the aggressiveness of the regulatory look back has been less than some people anticipated. But there is a formal requirement, and it could be energized in the next 10 years, and we should root for that. For program evaluation, this is something that both the Bush administration and the Obama administration have emphasized. And the level of evaluation of programs to get rid of those that aren't working and to devote funds to the ones that are is much higher than it was 15 years ago. But to institutionalize it, it remains a work in progress. If for those who are interested in this, there's a memorandum from the Office of Management and Budget, I think maybe two or three, that have the word evaluation in it. And they involve funding requests. So the budget is being transformed into an evidence-based budget. Now, once the budget goes to Congress, the relationship between the evaluation process and what emerges might not be one-to-one. But this is, as the gist of your question suggests, this is incredibly important.
In building that evaluation evidence base, what is the relationship between academia and government in the U.S., and how do they work together to do that?
My understanding is very little. So that the evaluation of the regulations has no academic, zero academic role. It's all done internally. The program evaluation, I'm unaware of any academic evaluation. Though if academics do something that's useful, then the government is all ears. On the behavioral approaches, what we've been discussing, the academics have done some terrifically useful things. And some of the things I described grows out of academic work. For academic evaluation of, let's say, an educational policy, it's hard. And the government's going to have a lot more data available to it than the academic institution. This would be a good thing to promote, more as your opening remarks suggested, more engagement with people who quite know what they're doing to see how does the program look.
Do we have, oh, sorry.
Here, I've just got a mic on.
Oh, you have a mic here.
Yeah, I'll come.
So you're second, sorry.
All right. You mentioned before the fact that the effectiveness of education campaign is quite limited when they bump against social norms. And I was interested in the relationship between kind of behavioral interventions and social norms, and what kind of behavioral interventions seem to be nudging social norms or capable of nudging social norms.
So we don't have a lot of data. And partly, I think one reason is that there aren't randomized controlled trials. So the way you'd want to do it, ideally, is to have a campaign, let's say, involving domestic violence in one community and then in another community and see what happens. Or to have five different domestic violence campaigns and then see what happens. And on this area, I think at least the governments I'm aware of are really at very early stages. So absent a randomized controlled trial, all we can do is have before and after pictures and speculation. And the before and after pictures, it is true that with respect to smoking and drunk driving, there have been very significant reductions in multiple countries, though the causal force of the public education campaign is hard to sort out. I think the kind of theoretical interest of your question is, under what circumstances would a public education campaign kind of catch a wave and promote an emerging norm? And in what circumstances would a public educational campaign run up against a rock or maybe even prove counterproductive because it fuels an emerging norm that's running up in exactly the opposite direction? So I think there's one little clue about there is some work on this, the phenomenon of compliance without enforcement. This is a beautiful phenomenon. When is it the case that we observe compliance with a requirement with no enforcement? And in many places, smoking bans kind of automatically produce compliance. You don't need the government to step in. Why is that? It seems to be there's a sufficiently widely held norm already that once the practice comes in, those who would want to smoke know that they will incur private sanctions. And you need the law, though, to make the private sanctions sufficiently likely. It might be without the law, people would smoke, people would say, please stop smoking, they'd say, I have a right to smoke. They can't give that answer anymore. So that fits with at least one area where public educational campaigns are promising. They put the government's imprimatur behind a majority sentiment. The qualification for the compliance without enforcement finding is there are some communities where compliance is zero or low, because these are groups where smoking is consistent with the norm, and those who want to stop them smoking look like intermeddlers or busybodies. And so the question is, under what circumstances is a public education campaign going to look like intermeddlers or busybodies? So one way to get at this is to think the source of the message is extremely important, sometimes as important as the content of the message. So in cases where the messenger is easily dismissed as fussy or other, then there's a problem. And I'm thinking of the domestic violence issue, where I know there's a lot of interest here. There are some communicators who would be like, not very helpful. But there are others who maybe would get people's attention if they look kind of relevantly like the people at whom they're targeted. So one little idea about public education campaigns, a source is often effective if the person's a convert or a surprise. So if you have a former alcoholic saying, don't drink, that's better, often. If you have someone who, let's say, was engaged in domestic violence, who is communicating and saying that this was, not only did I get punished, I'm full of shame, and I'll never get over it. Something like that. That could be effective.
So I guess we have one back here, and then one over here, and then one here. Maybe.
It's a pattern. It's a spiral.
You noted on one of your slides the importance of learning from negative results. I wonder if you could comment on a nudge that didn't work and what your thoughts were for why it didn't work.
Okay, so the United States team has a couple of them as reported as not working. The mind is a wondrous thing, meaning that my mind has blocked out the content of the ones that have failed. My understanding is that the following intervention, it's not clear it's always getting positive results. So I want to phrase it in this tentative way. But the intervention is have people sign forms first, and you'll get more honesty. There's a lot of good data suggesting that works. There's some data suggesting it might not work. And so whether that's a universally helpful idea, unclear. Another one that may or may not work, this might have been one of the ones in the US report, is the use of social norms to get people to pay their taxes by pointing toward what the relevant community does. It's not clear that's always going to work. So if you have a group of people who are proud of the fact that they're not like their awful community of, goody-goodies, we don't pay our taxes here because we are proudly whatever, then when they hear that people in their community pay their taxes, they say, well, I'm not like people in my community. So the delinquent taxpayer issue is one where I'm not clear enough that there has been a negative result to use it as an example, but there's a potential negative result. I'll give you one. Okay, I have one that I haven't suppressed, that's a beautiful one and keenly revealing, which is the OECD, as a test of the power of default rules, turned down thermometers in the winter by 1 degree Celsius in winter. That produced the result, significant decrease in energy use. Then they decreased it by, for another group, by 2 degrees Celsius, the default setting, had much less of an impact. That, I think, is deeply interesting, that the more aggressive default had a weaker impact than the weaker default on the goal, which was decreased energy use. That shouldn't have happened. The reason it happened was that if your default setting is set down 2 degrees Celsius, you're cold, and you turn it up. Now, the reason that has a generalizable implication is you might think nudges in the form of default rules will work unless they make people too cold, where cold means uncomfortable, mad, poor, whatever.
I'm interested in unintended consequences. Particularly the unintended consequences of a nudge intervention as it interacts with other parts of the regulatory framework. There was a question earlier about Australian savings rates, and you suggested one approach might be to have a kind of default minimum and then additional top-up opt-in savings. I think most of the locals in the room can guess what would happen in that instance right now. Because of the interaction with our tax system, you'd get enormous contributions at the top end and very little at the bottom. How do you respond to something like that? You suggested kind of it's an empirical question. I guess, do you test and retest around what the right levels are? And if so, how do you do that at a small scale on something as universal as the tax code?
Okay, great. So this is related to another nudge, which is imperfectly successful because it had an unintended consequence. So it unites the two questions. The nudge I'm thinking of is automatic enrollment and savings. And one thing that did in the early days that was not good was it increased participation rates but decreased contribution rates. The reason it decreased contribution rates is the default contribution was low, 3%. And for the very reason that you increase participation, you decrease contributions. That's terrible, 3% too low. So something has to be done to make that unintended consequence not work. It's a predictable unintended consequence. It's what you should observe if the default is sticky. Okay, so that would be not so good unintended consequence. That was tested not through population-wide, but just at firms. Not huge firms, big firms. What are we observing? Increases in participation rates, decrease in contribution rates. So it would be possible to do at, I think, in terms of practice, whether in terms of political feasibility is another question, but it would be possible to say, okay, at this firm we're going to have a savings rate of 6%, not opt in for the other, though you could test that too, opt out for the other, and then see who's opting out. One thing that bears on your point, by the way, about disparities between rich and poor, you might expect that in an opt-out design, in a thing where dollars are involved, poor people are going to be opting out. They need the money. You might expect that. There's data suggesting exactly the opposite, that poor people don't opt out. Why do they not opt out? Because they're busy. Whether that's an opportunity or something to worry over, I think is a good question. People who lack education and resources are often less likely to use, let's say, the freedom of choice safety valve. That might be good if you're really confident that you've got it right, but if it's harmful for them, not so much. So the short answer to your question is, it should be possible with populations of hundreds, just to see what's happening. And undoubtedly there would be surprises.
Hi, I was really interested in your comments around poverty and cognitive capacity, and it's something that we're definitely seeing when we work with more disadvantaged family groups, that if we can make things simpler for them and remove some barriers, that we can increase capacity and get them on a different pathway. But what I'm interested in is the broader side of that is the social context. How do you nudge the broader community to not look at those whichever client group you're talking about as others, but to actually start to care about the programs that can create these inroads, because I think some of the things that we see is that we know these programs work, but we need broad community support to keep things going. And often the groups that are seen as others, I suppose, in the community are even more disadvantaged by the discrimination that they might get from the broader community that do see them as, I guess, not deserving or not making the right choices. So how do you nudge the broader community when your focus is on better outcomes for disadvantaged groups?
Okay, so if the broader community's indifference or hostility to the programs matters, in the sense that you can't get the programs going because they're unpopular, that is a serious problem. The phrase that seems to capture what is helpful is, "There but for the grace of God go I." So if there's an ability to inculcate an understanding that, you know, those of us are doing well, probably got some luck of large magnitude through a lottery of some kind, that's a way in. Now, if there's good faith disagreement about whether the program is justified, then it's not an absence of empathy, it's kind of a policy disagreement. And then have to talk about the policy. I'm thinking a little bit about the program to which I referred, the Earned Income Tax Credit, which is, do you have something like that, by the way? Do working people who are not earning a lot of money get a tax credit or a supplement? Some people are nodding. Apparently it's not the most well-known program in Australia. It's, or my barbaric accent is making the question incomprehensible. So that program is pretty broadly supported on the ground that the relevant group, that is the working poor, aren't people to whom there's large indifference. I'm thinking about, you know, I don't have a good answer to your question, which is one reason why I'm wandering. I'm thinking that, you know, I think well-off democracies should be focusing on the mentally ill and people who are suffering from chronic pain. Those are two groups that, you know, if your arm doesn't work, or if you've moved from one city to another and it's less nice, or some other misfortune has hit you, you can adjust to that. One reason is attention, that it, make the metaphor extend, if you are, if you don't see the fly, then you don't pay attention to it, and many misfortunes are like a urinal without a fly. Just don't think about them. But if you're suffering from chronic pain or mental illness, then it is not possible not to be suffering. I mean, maybe you can get used to some extent to chronic pain, but that's hard. Those are two categories where empathy by the part on the part of people who don't have these problems should be easy to trigger. Because there's but for the grace of God, certainly for chronic pain and for many people mental illness also.
I think so there were two questions here. You had one, and I think somewhere about four or five rows behind you. Yeah, so maybe, do you want to go first in front here? Okay. And then someone over there is going to ask a question next. So.
Thank you. My question is about ways to collect evidence. So we've talked about collecting evidence through randomized trials. You've compared the results of various policy programs. Clearly that can be expensive and raise ethical choices. But so are there other ways using experimental techniques to help us in the design process? And do you have examples of that?
Okay, great. So the interventions I described, the various policies, I don't think one of them was a product of a randomized trial. They either borrowed from academic research, which suggested they would work, or they were a result of quasi-experiments or websites. So for the redesigned fuel economy rule, just a lot of people were interacting with websites, and then various questions were asked, do you understand this? What kind of car would you buy given this? And that provided information. So using even relatively small groups that are on the internet or brought in to see their comprehension and behavior. It's not as good as a randomized controlled trial, but it's cheaper. Also, you can sometimes have before and after pictures. It's hard to control for the variables, but if the result is large enough and the situations are proximate in space and time enough, you know this is probably what did it.
Thank you, Cass. So we in the public sector are relatively new to behavioral insights, but in the private sector, people have been using nudge and behavioral insights for a very long time. So I wonder, how do we think about the scenarios in which public policy and private actions interact? And specifically, I guess I'd draw on the example of overdraft protection in the US, where though the government came up with a policy to get rid of that protection for a lot of people, banks were quite successful in keeping people within the system by appealing to loss aversion and other behavioral levers.
Right, so the banking example, I gave you a very cheerful version, and I basically believe it, but not everyone does. The fact is that the level of overdraft protection participation was incredibly high in the United States before the rule. A lot of people hoped the rule would cut the level of participation in these programs, you know, close to zero. It didn't. The program cut to somewhere between 20 and 50% across different banks. And one reason, as you say, that they got people involved was they sent ads out saying, please check one of two boxes. Yes, exclamation point. I want to keep the overdraft protection that I've long enjoyed. No, I want to lose my long-term, the protection I've enjoyed. And people check yes. So they're agile at that. I guess one question is whether the program is one that the regulated sector is very unhappy with or whether it likes it. In the context of the environment and savings, it's possible that the regulated entity is very happy with the government. In the context of calorie labeling or things that are know before you owe, it's possible that the private sector will be unhappy. I think all that can be done is to have a continuing process so that if there's an agile effort to counteract what the government has done, then maybe that effort itself needs scrutiny if it involves, if it imposes costs that exceed its benefits. So the banking one, I'm not quite sure of. I'm not quite sure how to think of the participation. Maybe those are people who need a convenient, even though frequently high interest loan. The dollar amounts aren't high. What else are they going to do? Are they going to go to a payday lender? That's probably worse. It might be okay. But the private sector's agility at counteracting, of course, that's something to keep in mind. One thing I'd say, by the way, about the private sector, since I've been out of government, I've been intrigued by this. At least in the United States, I'm sure if this isn't true here, soon it will be. The private sector is much more disciplined and creative in using behavioral science than it was 5 or 6 years ago. So as much as there's increased government use of the material, the private sector is not, you know, a long-term user, but is now getting up to speed and sometimes, as you say, way ahead of government. That's often an opportunity as well as a challenge. It's an opportunity if the private sector's incentives are the right ones. So there are companies all over the world that are interested in combating obesity and in promoting healthier choices. They think that's economically beneficial for them and they think it's a social good. And they're using behavioral strategies. CVS, you know the company Consumer Value Services? CVS has gone kind of behavioral in its behavior, so to speak, partly because it's really focused on health, and that's defining its mission.
Great. I think we're at time. Can I ask you one quick question, which is about the child meal program in the U.S. You said you wanted these programs to be choice preserving. To what degree may parents have chosen that they don't want to accept government assistance because they have some strong political objections?
Oh, they're completely free to opt out. So if you don't want your kids to be in those programs, go for it. So one analogy, do you have automatic voter registration here? Do you have to register to vote, or are you?
It's compulsory.
It's compulsory. Okay, so no mere nudge. Okay, highly relevant to your question, because you might think, what if people don't want to be voters? I guess that is inconsistent with the norm, but take this again as an analogy, if the example doesn't resonate. Oregon and California have just adopted automatic voter registration. So people, if they know you're a citizen, you're a voter. You don't have to register, but you can opt out.
And we have a low-income tax offset, which is like the ITC, but less covers less of the population. So anyway, Cass, fantastic stuff.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you all.